Right. Okay. Can you all hear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you understood the objectives. The way this lecture is prepared is we'll give you a case scenario and try to see whether you could diagnose it and then discuss about that diagnosis. But before we start, I want to stress one point, that is headache is a very common symptom. Most of them, if you just guess and say it's a migraine, about 10 to 12.5% or even sometimes more than that, you are correct. And if you said it's either migraine or tension type headache, you are about 24% time it's correct. But that doesn't mean that all these patients are having migraine or tension type headache. So even if So it's so common, it's very common among the community. So even if the patient gives a history of migraine, you must see whether this particular attack that he comes with is compatible with a previous diagnosis of migraine, or is it something new? This is very important. So, okay, you can go for the most likely diagnosis, but exclude other causes, especially the important and dangerous causes which requires urgent treatment. Naguni, any reason why you raised hand?
No, sir. It's missed.
Excellent. Right, okay. You have to take a detailed history regarding headaches. We will discuss what these details are and relevant important points in the examination, because you may not be able to, especially in a clinic setup, you may not be able to examine all the system fully. And sometimes you may need to do basic investigations. At the same time, you cannot do imaging or MRI or CT and lumbar punctures in all these patients. You must remember that, so you have to go basically by the history. All the details of the pain should be inquired to. You know the famous acronym Socrates. I don't like acronyms, but this is sight, is radiation and all that. And the duration. If it's a very short duration, for example, if somebody says I have a headache for 1 week, you have to be more careful than if somebody says I have headache for 10 years. We will discuss what short-term headaches and the long-standing headaches are likely to be. Frequency is very important, daily or intermittent. Intermittent headaches, if they are lasting for maybe one day or less than 24 hours, they are more likely to be migraines. Whereas if there is a headache, daily headache, again, you have to be a bit careful and more careful and look for other causes. You have to ask for sinister features, and we'll tell you what these sinister features are. Then the family history is very important, because if there is an intermittent headache with family history, you are more or less certain that it's likely to be a migraine. And medication is important in many ways, but you may already know that there is an entity called analgesic induced headache, and history of medication. If somebody takes paracetamol daily for headache, then it's very important that you avoid that. When you are examining the patient, you have to, especially if the patient is acutely ill, you must look for fever, whether the patient is anemic. In patients with chronic, some of the chronic illnesses like temporal arthritis, the patient can be anemic, whether the patient is in pain or ill, frontal tenderness and so forth. Ear discharges, temporal artery tenderness are very important, because we not only look at the neurological aspect of causes of headache, there can be other causes in the other system which can cause headache and present with headache. So, evidence of arthritis, vasculitis, coma scale is important if the patient is very ill. Next incessant turning sign is a must in a patient with a short duration of headache. You all must be able to examine the optic fundi and identify papilledema And generally, it is expected you should be able to identify papilledema, optic atrophy, diabetic retinopathy, and hypertensive retinopathy on fundal examination. And this is likely to appear in your exam at some stage. Cranial nerve examination can be quickly done, and you must look for focal neurological signs in limbs quickly. If so sometimes other systems need to be examined. Okay, now we are going to these case scenarios. So in these scenarios, imagine that this patient is seated in front of you for consultation, and you have to take a decision on the patient's, depending on the patient's history. But remember that not all these cases are common, but it is important that you recognize them to avoid any disastrous results by missing the diagnosis. A patient came to a rural hospital with headache for 2 weeks, gradually worsening. Headache is very severe in the morning, while coughing, sneezing, and straining. The patient also complains of vomiting in the morning. What is the most likely diagnosis? What are the physical signs that could be present in this patient? What is your action? So, what do you think is the likely diagnosis? What should you consider first in this patient?
To think of a sinister cause here.
Yeah, it is a sinister cause. What type of sinister cause is there when the patient has an early morning headache, increase with coughing, sneezing, and straining, and vomiting in the morning? What does that indicate generally?
A tumor, brain tumor.
Well, that indicates raised intracranial pressure. Yeah, very good. Raised intracranial pressure. And what physical signs would you look for in this patient? In short, if there's a raised intracranial pressure, what are the physical signs that could be present?
Papilledema.
Yes, you had to look for papilledema. Any other physical signs? Especially some student mentioned that it could be a space occupant lesion, so, or tumor. Then what are the other signs that you would look for?
Focal neurological signs.
Very good, yeah. So you must look for focal neurological signs. And what is your action? I have included the context also into the picture. So patient has come to a rural hospital, and I said patient is seated in front of you. What is your action now? Anybody? Yeah, Samsung? Yes. What would you do if there is if you have suspected the space occupant lesion? What would you do?
CT and MRI.
Yeah, you have to do a CT scan or imaging. CT is available in most of the base hospitals, so you can transfer. You should transfer this patient to a hospital where CT facilities are available. And of course, depending on the situation that we are given, if the patient is in severe pain, you have to give some analgesics, right? So the features that tell us this is important and the referral is needed is that 2 weeks, a short history, relatively short history, and early in the worsening, and it's gradually worsening. and early in the morning has sinister features. So that's those are the reasons why what made us to diagnose this. And then we have to refer him immediately to a center with imaging facilities. So that's papilledema. As I said, you must know how to diagnose papilledema, optic atrophy, normal fundus, hypertensive retinopathy, and diabetic retinopathy. This is an example of a large tumor. Although they are large, this like to be meningioma in the phalanx posteriorly, and having that, and it's so large that the skull is eroded, and actually in this patient there was a sort of a lump, bulging soft lump over the scalp, and I never believed when the mother said that, but that was there when I felt that. This is the same thing in a different view in the MRI. Right. We go to the case number 2, a 25-year-old previously held man is admitted with sudden severe headache in the occipital and frontal region with vomiting and giddiness. On examination, he had neck stiffness and positive Koenig sign. What is the most likely diagnosis? Answer?
Subarachnoid hemorrhage.
Yes, very good. What is your immediate action? Now this patient is admitted, assuming that it's a profinate goal. What is your immediate action?
Nimodipine.
Yeah, you have to give nimodipine. What else? We discussed this last time. Don't you control the pain and vomiting?
CT brain.
Yeah, non-contrast CT brain. And you know the details of how to manage it. We have discussed this last time. Again, the important points are highlighted there. This we have already discussed last time. This is a picture of a subarachnoid hemorrhage. I think I showed the same picture during the last lecture also. So there is blood in the subarachnoid space and in the sulci, they are all filled with blood. But sometimes you may not see a dramatic picture like that. And you might see just some blood somewhere. So you have to be very careful in interpreting it. Or CT scan always should be viewed in a X-ray viewer. We have discussed this again, how to manage it. So we will not spend time on that. And this also I have shown the other day. Right. A 34-year-old man is presented with fever, headache, vomiting, and weakness of the right side of the body. He has taken treatment for a middle ear infection 5 days back. On examination, patient was drowsy and had papilledema, flaccid right hemiplegia with upgoing plantar response. Questions? What diagnosis would you consider in this patient? What immediate investigation would you be of diagnostic value? Diagnosis?
A cerebral abscess.
Cerebral abscess, yes. Investigation?
CT scan.
CT scan. Okay. You know the reason why we mentioned that. Again, we have discussed this during. I did a lecture on CNS infection, so you have already know this. And the important thing is, if there's a suspicion of meningococcal meningitis, that is different from this, in a patient with headache, you must always give a first shot of at least penicillin before you transfer this patient. Right. So this again is shown that the question may be the same. The patient, the case scenario given may be the same, but the situation may be different. Depending on the situation, your action may be different. Okay. Now we'll go to the next. Now if this patient is admitted to a tertiary care center, we'll do a, if possible, we'll do urgent contrast CT rather than non-contrast CT. We'll start antibiotic eflaxon and metronidazole, and if there are skull fractures or something, then you have to add other drugs. Although it's an infection, intravenous dexamethasone will reduce the inflammatory edema and the patient's disability may improve. So with antibiotics, you can start dexamethasone and urgent referral to the neurosurgeon. And of course, while waiting for the neurosurgeon, you must look for why this patient has developed a cerebral abscess, whether it's a complication of a meningitis or whether it's a spread from a local site like otitis media or middle ear infection, or whether the patient has cyanotic congenital heart disease. Right. Now, having finished those cases, now we have to consider when a patient comes to us, whether before doing anything else, you must see whether the patient has the sinister features of any of these causes. Any subarachnoid hemorrhage, you know, it's a sudden severe headache. Intracranial hemorrhage, okay, it's a sudden severe headache with focal neurological signs. Space occupant lesions, we discussed what they have. And intracranial infections, neck stiffness, kerning signs, confusion, focal neurological signs are very important. There are two other important non-neurological, possibly considered as non-neurological causes of headache. One is acute tangle closure, glaucoma, and this year, this had been one of the questions. We will be discussing these cases in the next few minutes, but you must always, even if the patient has a typical history of migraine, the patient says I had headache for 20 years, you must always ask whether this headache is also similar to the previous ones or is it different. If the patient says no, this is different and this is severe, I have never had a headache like this, you must always consider other causes. Anyway, if you are seeing a patient for the first time, it's always a good practice to exclude all these cases. Quickly, you can just ask him a few questions by looking at the patients. You can exclude most of the things. Okay. What about this patient? 40-year-old lady presented to OPD with long-standing intermittent headache, starting on one side of the head with an aura of bright lights and becoming severe with pulsating character. The patient is irritable with the noise, during the attack and like to sleep in a dark room and start vomiting. Frequency is about 4 attacks per month. Examination was completely normal when the patient did not have a headache. What is the most likely diagnosis? you all may have seen it.
Migraine.
Yeah, it's a classical case of migraine. And in fact, earlier they were called classical migraine. Now we call them a migraine with aura because there's a visual aura, migraine with visual aura. It is very important for you to have, if all these features are there, it is very likely to be migraine, but still you have to do a quick examination of the nervous system and the especially optic fundi. So there may be a aura, commonly a visual aura of scintillating scotoma, or sometimes you can have aura of vertigo, aura of numbness, and sometimes in hemiplegic migraine, weakness. It is of unilateral onset generally, but sometimes it may be generalized onset. But if it is unilateral onset, and generally speaking, in migraine patients, it never occurs on the same site every day. There are patients like that. But if it occurs on the same site every day, or the days that the patient has headache, you have to be a little careful and you have to consider possibility of other diagnosis. It's a pulsating quality. It can be associated with nausea and vomiting. Most of the time, vomiting generally relieves the headache, the patient says. It can last for 4 hours or up to 72 hours. Yeah, scotoma, somebody has asked what the scotoma is. By now you should know it. Anyway, scotoma is a loss of vision in one area of the visual field. So they generally has photophobia and phonophobia, and precipitating factors are these are spelling mistake there. If you have broken sleep or fasting, going in the sun, and some people in the perimenstrual period. Some people get it during menstrual period, bleeding, and some others during the mid-cycle. And of course, they can have a family history. Now, this is the International Classification of Headache Criteria for diagnosis of migraine. So the important thing is at the end you say not attributable to another disorder, which means that even if you think the diagnosis is migraine, you must quickly ask for the other causes. So the criteria includes 5 attacks fulfilling B to D. Headache should last for more than 4 to 72 hours. At least it should have at least unilateral location or pulsating quality and moderate or severe pain intensity. It is aggravated by walking or climbing stairs, and during headache, at least there is nausea, vomiting, photophobia, phonophobia, all what I mentioned earlier in the slide. But the important issue is that they should not be attributable to any other cause. Otherwise, because sometimes even headaches of a focal lesion may present like a migraine, which may not be there all the time. So it's very important to exclude other causes. There are different types of migraines, and of course, different names also were given sometimes for these headaches. Migraine with aura is called classical migraine, and without aura is called common migraine now. Earlier it was called common migraine, now we call it migraine without aura. And basilar migraine is also called vestibular migraine, where the vestibular symptoms like vertigo, ease, or sweating sometimes are commoner. There's an entity called a hemiplegia migraine, where with the attack of migraine, you get hemiplegia. Again, it's a familial condition. It's also called familial hemiplegia migraine. But if there is no family history, and if the hemiplegia occurs all the time on the same site, you should not diagnose hemiplegic migraine, and you must always exclude a vascular malformation in the brain commonly and various other focal lesions. So hemiplegic migraine for the first time in a first member of the family is diagnosis of exclusion. There's again another entity called retinal migraine, where the people go blind and they again, after some time, they receive vision. But this again is a diagnosis of exclusion. You don't generally diagnose retinal migraine by your experience. You exclude all the other causes. Then there's an entity called a migraine, semicephalgia, migraine without headache, and all sorts of names. There are the patients can have other symptoms of migraine like weakness, numbness, vertigo, but without a significant headache. In this type of patients, again, different diagnoses need to be considered as differential diagnosis. Treatment of migraine is very important and part of the question. Acute attacks, minor attacks can be treated with paracetamol or paracetamol plus codeine combination or even aspirin, but that aspirin has gone out of fashion. And severe attacks can be treated with beta NSAIDs like ibuprofen or sodium potassium. And generally, if you combine NSAIDs with domperidone, regardless of whether the patient has vomiting or not, it appears to be better than NSAIDs alone. This is because during migraine attack, the patient develop gastroparesis so that the drug may not be absorbed properly. So we believe that adding domperidone helps in that way. Of course, I have said in very severe attacks you give triptans, but now triptans are available and some of the triptans are not very expensive, and so you can give them for moderate severe attacks as well. So the preparations available in Sri Lanka are sumatriptan, which is very expensive, and then there is another preparation, solmitriptan. Now, solmitriptan nasal sprays are also available in Sri Lanka. So, for patients with more than minor attack, you can prescribe triptans. Now, acute prophylaxis, that is when the patient gets aura, you can give triptans as a prophylaxis, and some people give NSAIDs also. But if the attacks are very frequent, at least more than 2 per month, we are supposed to give, and if they are very severe disabling attacks, then we got to prevent them. The drugs used are propranolol, amitriptyline, verapamil can be given, cypriptidine, prednisone, and topiramate can be given. Cypriptidine and prednisone will cause significant weight gain because they increase the appetite. Topiramate is a good drug for obese patients that will reduce the appetite, and sometimes patients may lose weight. Another important side effect of prednisone is that it can cause galactorrhea and menstrual irregularities. So you have to, especially when you are treating young girls and women, you have to alert them on this possibility. Otherwise, they will end up doing MRI scans and pituitary scans and pituitary hormone profiles and all sorts of things. Okay. We'll discuss another case. A 35-year-old business executive presented with a long-standing daily headache all over the head, becoming severe towards the evening, and with a feeling of band around the head. Examination is completely normal. What is the most likely diagnosis and what drug would you select to treat this patient? Can anybody answer?
Tension type headache.
Yeah, that's very good. Tension type headache. What's the drug would you, what drug would you select? Next slide will show it. Yeah. This diagnosis very likely to be tension type. Again, I will show you the diagnostic criteria. You have to exclude other things anyway. Amitriptyline is a very effective drug for tension type headache, and most of the other drugs which are used for migraine might not work with tension type headache. And of course, there are many non-pharmacological measures that you can adopt. Relaxation exercises, meditations, normal physical exercises, changing your routines and having a sort of a stop a monotonous life, and you have a mixture of things to do. That type of things will relieve tension type headache in many patients, but some patients need drug treatment. Okay, now if you go to the diagnostic criteria for tension type headache, there are two things. One is called episodic tension type headache, and the other one is called frequent episodic tension type headache. But in both, you have to, it should not be attributable to any other disorder. For example, if there is a patient with tension type headache and if the patient has focal weakness, you never diagnose them as tension type headache. So infrequent ones, 10 or less is sort of taken as cutoff point. It lasts for more than 30 minutes. It's generally bilateral and like a band. It generally is not aggravated by routine physical activity like walking or climbing stairs. They have no nausea or vomiting. And photophobia or phonophobia can occur, but if both are there, it is unlikely to be tension type headache. And the important thing is, although you know from the history that it's very likely to be tension type headache, you must examine them thoroughly to exclude other causes. So, the most important message to be given so far is that in all patients with suspected primary headaches like tension type or migraine, so some of the primary headaches that we are going to discuss later, you must quickly exclude sinister causes before you reassure the patient, no, there is nothing to worry, there is no need to do an imaging. Let's look at this patient. Presented with a daily headache, generally occurring at 2 a.m. in the morning. The headache is always on the right forehead and the eye, right eye. And he gets, there's some spelling mistake there, tearing from the right eye. He feels blocking of the right nasal canal during the attack. He shouts in pain and try analgesics. The pain disappears after about 1 hour and restarts roughly at the same time the next day. Except for a scar in the forehead, examination is normal when the patient is asymptomatic. So what's a, okay? You can see this patient, it's a case of a real patient. He had this scar and he has tears, it is during an attack. So what's the diagnosis?
Cluster headache.
Yeah, very good. It's very likely to be cluster headache. In fact, we also thought it is a cluster headache. And what's the treatment during acute attack? The best treatment if the patient is in the ward. This is an MCQ also. Yeah, oxygen therapy. You give 100% oxygen if possible, and the headache will subside quickly. So I have written that in the BHT, and in the evening, I got a call from a registrar. Okay, this patient had developed that headache. We gave him oxygen inhalation. In fact, he got worse, and the dosage also got worse. So I was puzzled. But anyway, this is the picture the next day. He has developed proptosis and swelling, periorbital swelling, and redness of the eye. And now what? So if the pain does not respond to oxygen, it's extremely unlikely to be a cluster headache. So this patient needs further investigations, and the patient said it was worse in the morning. So one question you must ask is whether the patient has postnasal drip or whether she has to clear the throat all the time. So this is not a common case. I put it because this is one of the few pictures where we see the tearing during the headache. Okay, if the diagnosis is cluster headache, now mind you, that patient, you cannot label it as cluster headache because we cannot exclude other causes. In fact, CT showed sinusitis in the frontal sinuses, I think, and a fungal sinusitis. But he got better. He got better with treatment. Cluster headache can be easily treated with subcutaneous sumatriptan. Oral ones can be given if there is no subcutaneous preparation available, but now we have solmetriptan nasal spray. So with solmetriptan nasal spray, cluster headache patients will improve. And of course, that is acute attack, but if you want to go on this episode or cluster to be controlled, you have to do some preventive therapy. The most effective and quick preventive therapy is prednisolone. So we start prednisolone, but better all. So we'll start verapamil also at the same time. So because then we can quickly tail off prednisolone and continue with verapamil. So they can last about 2 months and then they get better. They never come back. Again, in about a year's time or 2 years' time, they will come with a headache of similar nature on the same site and the CT is normal. When they come for the first time, I still would like to do a CT scan of the brain and the sinuses, having had this experience. But generally speaking, in the exam, if it is a classical type of a first headache, examiners may not expect an imaging in a patient with a cluster headache. There is a group of headaches or cephalgias called trigeminal autonomic cephalgia. They include cluster headache, paroxysmal hemicrania, and a sunk syndrome. Sunk syndrome is actually the abbreviation for the short-lasting unilateral neuralgiform headache with conjunctival injection and tearing. Okay. So these three are lumped as trigeminal autonomic neuropathy. Or TAC syndrome, sometimes they are called. Now it's important for you to know, categorize different types of headaches, especially with regard to your easy, it's easy to diagnose them and easy to answer your questions also in your MCQs. What are the causes of unilateral headaches? Sinusitis, migraine, cluster headache, temporal arthritis, trigeminal neuralgia, it's a facial pain, referred pain from eye, ear, or tooth, or cervicogenic headache that's commonly localized to a occipital area. Okay, we'll go to the next case. A man presented with a unilateral headache on the right side of the forehead, which starts in the morning and subsides towards the daytime. The pain gets worse when he bends his head down. He had a recent history of upper respiratory infection. On examination, the examination is normal except tenderness below the right eye. What is the most likely diagnosis?
Sinusitis.
Yeah, it's very easy, sinusitis. And this is a sinus X-ray, CT scan of the sinus, sinuses in a patient with chronic sinusitis. In acute sinusitis, even see the CT might show fluid, but it's actually imaging is not necessary. Do you give antibiotic for acute sinusitis? Anybody? No, acute sinusitis is commonly viral. So you don't need to give, unless the secretions are yellowish and purulent, you don't need to treat them. But if they last long, then you have to, more than 2 weeks, then you have to treat them with antibiotics. A 58-year-old lady presented with a severe pain over the left forehead and eye with vomiting and giddiness for 2 days. She has blurred vision and sees a halo around the light. What is the most likely diagnosis? What is your action? Anybody?
Acute angle-closure glaucoma.
Yes, it's a classical history of acute angle-closure glaucoma, because sometimes acute angle-closure glaucoma, the headache can be so severe you might mistake that for even SAH or intracranial pathology. They are so, it's so severe, and they get vomiting, giddiness, and the patient will be very ill. Anyway, any if the question to ask is, of course, they can have a red dye, but the other question to ask is, when you look at the light, do you see any halos around the light, like a rasphalal? So if you see that, that's very suspicious of acute angle closure glaucoma, and your immediate action should be to refer to an eye surgeon. Another case, a 45-year-old lady is presented with a frequent episodes of severe short-lasting piercing pain over the angle of the jaw, which quickly radiates along the jaw. She holds her face when she gets an attack. So the attacks last for about few seconds to few minutes, and it is precipitated by washing face and brushing teeth. What is the most likely diagnosis?
Trigeminal neuralgia.
Very good, trigeminal neuralgia. And generally, they hold on to their head when they have a severe headache. And they just touch this and then release it. So, okay. So these patients, you must examine these patients thoroughly, especially the cranial nerve. If the patient has any cranial nerve signs, including absent corneal effects, the diagnosis is not trigeminal neuralgia. The diagnosis then is called trigeminal neuropathy. And if the patient has any other signs, of course, you never diagnose it, because sometimes a structural lesion also can cause similar pain. Treatment is generally gabapentin, amitriptyline is my choice. Carbamazepine, they are very effective treatment, but you must know that amitriptyline and carbamazepine should never be combined unless you are in a desperate situation, because they can cause heart blocks. We had the experience like that. But there are many other drugs like sodium valproate, phenytoin sodium also can be effective. But another effective treatment is botulinum toxin. You infiltrate the whole area of the trigeminal distribution with botulinum toxin, small doses. And so botulinum toxin blocks what? Botulinum toxin is a preganglionic acetylcholine blocker. So how can that helps in pain? Anybody who knows the answer? Yes. Actually, how the acetylcholine release is inhibited by botulinum toxin is now known. It is not the release, it is the what's called a docking protein, which is the vesicle with acetylcholine is docked. You know what? A ship is docked into the harbor. That crate is just dragged and docked into the surface by what's called a docking protein. Now, what botulinum toxin does is blocking that docking protein, right? So that can be with some other vesicles also, like with substance P. Substance P is the one which he knows in pain. So that's why botulinum toxin is also effective in pain control in neuralgic pain. You all must know the temporal artery situation is a middle-aged person, generally a female, but males also get it. And it's a localized head pain. So they say it's not a spinning headache, it's a head pain. And they sometimes point to the place, and there is always tender temporal arteries. And it may affect vision if it's arthritis. So it may affect vision if the ophthalmic artery is affected. In any middle-aged person coming with a headache, especially unilateral headache, it is advisable to do ESR. If it is very high, it's most likely to be temporal arthritis. But again, remember that there are many other possible causes of high ESR and a headache. You confirm the diagnosis with temporal artery biopsy. And if you give early steroid therapy, headache will improve dramatically, and you can prevent blindness. A man was brought by his wife with a severe headache in the morning hours around 10 o'clock. He is sleepy all the time, especially around 10 o'clock in the morning. Wife says she gets disturbed by his severe snoring at night. On examination, the patient was obese and tittering. Nervous system examination was normal. What is the most likely diagnosis? Anybody? Yeah. This is a classical case of sleep apnea. Many people who complain of daytime somnolence, you must inquire about their sleep. Now, daytime somnolence might not come and say they are sleepy, because sometimes they don't understand it. It may be just irritability. It may be, they may explain it as unsteadiness. They may explain it as the lapses of memory, short lapses of memory, which are also called microsleeps, because they go into sleep for a few seconds If you do an EEG, they will be in sleep, but within seconds they recover. During that period, their memory will be poor. So sleep apnea is a fairly common health problem in the society, and you must identify them. And losing weight is very useful for them. And of course, there are other equipment like positive pressure, what's called a CPAP, continuous positive pressure machines, and they make a dramatic change in their life. But in addition to sleep apnea, sleep deprivation is also another common cause of headache, which is common among advanced level students. When they come and see, some people sleep only for 2-3 hours a day, but probably that is not the way to pass exams. Right. Any questions? And try to download this link. Have you all received the link from your batch rep? Can somebody respond? The link for the feedback?
Yes, sir.
Right. Just click on that, and if now or later, and fill it up and submit so that I can evaluate my teaching how I can improve it later. Further. Any questions? We'll see what questions people have asked.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, ask. Yeah.
How does the oxygen therapy help in cluster headaches?
I also don't know the answer, but maybe due to vasoconstrictions. I don't know. I will also check whether there is any new development in the field. The exact mechanism is not known until recently, but I will check that. Thanks for asking.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
And somebody has asked how to ask for giddiness. Now, giddiness, that's the biggest problem that we have. There is no Singlish word for giddiness. Anything, any unusual symptom is explained as vertigo by the patients. My teachers have told me oluwa thonthu vela wage, but I haven't heard anybody coming and telling me that thonthu vela wage. So patients may say it's a vertigo, but you must ask about whether there's unsteadiness, whether it's excessive sleepiness, or that way. Again, I haven't found a good singular word for that. Even if you try hard and find a singular word, people may not understand that word, why what you mean. So it's better to listen to the patient and inquire whether you can ask karakavillak wage tiyenawada, and then get the description of that. Any other questions? Was the lecture useful? So would you like to have lectures like this? So listing of courses.
This is good, sir.
Yeah. We will try to do more and more lectures in this style, because this will keep you alert. And these are actually based on the questions that we ask in the exam, as well as the problems that you face in the ward and clinic setting. Okay, next lecture, we'll have it on next Monday at 2:00. I will send you the title, and Monday morning I will put them to the LMS. Did you all download the thing in the LMS? Did you check the LMS today morning?
Yes, sir.
Did you find the lecture?
Yes, sir, it was there.
Right, okay.
So the CNS infections remaining slides, we had some more left. Are we doing it next Monday?
Were there CNS infections, something left?
Yes, sir. You said you'll do it today because that day was going past 1 hour and we were tired.
Oh, I completely forget. I went by the schedule. Anyway, I will do. If you have you read that in the LMS?
So that lecture was in there, sir, the CNS infection.
Right.
We stopped at viral encephalitis.
Right. Okay. Next time, remind me so that I will start with that, and I will put a short topic for the rest of the lecture so that we can finish both. I will first start with the new lecture and then go for that, or we'll do it anyway. So Monday 2 to, can I go from 2 to 4 on Monday? You have no other lecture schedule yet?
No, sir.
So expect 2-hour lecture on Monday, right? Okay, thank you for joining, and I would appreciate if you can send this feedback today itself so that we can analyze and see how to improve these lectures. Thank you very much, and have a nice weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.